can I flee from you? Even if I hide on the highest mountain, you are there. Where can I run from your presence? Where can I flee from you? Even if I lie in the lowest valley, you will find me still. Sing deeper than
any ocean.
Your
love goes on and on and on and on.
And higher than
any mountain.
Your
love goes on and on and on and on.
Sing deeper than
any ocean.
Your love goes on
and on and on and on.
And God, higher than any mountain.
Your love goes on and on and on and on.
And if I clothe myself in shadow, would I fade away from you? No, even if I run to the deepest darkness, your love surrounds me. No, even if I run to the deepest darkness, your love surrounds me still. Sing
deeper than any ocean.
Your love goes on and on and on and on. And God, higher than any mountain. Your love goes on and on and on and on. Sing deeper than any ocean.
Your love goes on and on and on and on.
And God, higher than any mountain. Your love goes on and on and on and on.
But if I am to die, let me die for Jesus. Let my knuckles crack. Let my bones crumble. Let my knees shatter. Let my footsteps stumble. Let my marrow dry. And let my teeth rot. Let my elbows fly fast into the grave. For a slumber to flesh is a wake-up call to eternity in Christ. Look at the scripture. Look at the verse. Look at the man, the apostle Paul, that scribbling scribe writes something golden in Galatians. Behind verse 19, but before verse 21, in chapter 2, there's a sermon written in 45 words. I am crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ that lives in me. And the life that I live now in faith, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. So, Christ didn't stagger up them steps to the cross in vain. But he walked so that we might have the freedom to bear witness to his pain, to reign in his pain, to rejoice in his pain. My blood was shed too. But my blood was so stinking and filthy and turning to the stomach that he shed his also so that I might taste the sweetest name of heaven. Man, all that is fuel for a fire in Christ. That if we believe, if we should die to greed, lust, envy, sin's dominion, worldly living, swings are missing the curveballs that Jesus throws to hypocrites and lukewarms alike. They not dead yet. They still living on the world's salary. We not dead yet. We still living on the world's salary. But it is the Christ that lives in us. He's on there eating up all the calories on our plate. The carrots, the potatoes, the celery, the walking, the talking, the living, the breathing, the melodies we sing in the shower in this hour. It is he that lives in us. And who is that he? Why? The same spirit that formed this earth in his hand, the same spirit that spoke dust into man, the same spirit that put the water in my glands to sweat off the pores when I'm running for Jesus. We should walk as if we have the power, because, watch this, we do. So, the last part of the meat, not the fat, nor the grist, but the bone of the word details where we put our trust in. And sometimes I be having to check where I put my trust in. Do I put my trust in Old Navy discounts where the colors blend? Or do I put them into Regions bank account withdrawals where the money spends, or into fantasy where desire cries a quiver of a woman so exaggerated that they can't even measure to the realistic depiction of a woman in any car or any bike? It sends a shiver down my back that I could even idolize anything other than the Christ who saved my life. So I shall cleave fast onto the invisible, visible hand that dribbles crossovers into the paint and dunks on the devil's head. My faith is in the Messiah, Jesus Christ. To the world, I am dead. But to him, I have new life.
You are Alpha and Omega. We worship you, our Lord. You are worthy to
unparalleled and exponentially distributed among the masses. Often raw, and it hurts when unconditional, but never not necessary to complete the task at hand. Capable enough to analytically dissect or either overwhelmingly annihilate the thick slabs of granite, also known as self-preservation levees, constructed around the heart to keep his sacred saving blood from getting in, indirectly disallowing the septic tank of sin from pouring out. Perfect precursor, prerequisite for a spiritual heart attack. Critical care patients all around, yet unaware the diagnosis of death is on the next page of your novel. Where are we but frolicking down the corridors of consummation with everything but Jesus Christ? God save us. God remind us. Love is a dying tree, dipped in bitter water, made sweet the tree of life, broken souls now complete. Bruised, battered, bloodied, and beaten, love is our Savior, dying on the cross to preserve holiness at the ultimate cost. Love is the handsome and noble aroma of God's presence as it fills the atmosphere after the earth's showers have receded, the beautiful balance of God's essence. Love is that wooden cross, splintered, splattered, and soiled with water and blood, discarded in the mud, but in its cracks, in its crevices, all of my sins that my Father deemed proper to rid the earth of. Love is God, and that separates him from man. Yet he still loved us enough to visit this land. So I will worship my King and give back true love, for he is holy and worthy of his eternal, omnipotent throne.
Shattered halos, splintered wings, and soft soil. We spit on his commandments like elementary playground contest. Play hide and seek in gated gardens, never to be seen again. These backyard games motivated by fear. Aware of the rules we break. Unconcerned with the state of the heart of the God who created the rules. It too ripping like pages. Like ligaments and knees that don't kneel at altars. Like checks that never band-aid themselves in the pockets of the poor. Like pieces of glass. And these palms exalting myself is exhausting, I see. How dark it is apart from thee, and isn't it amazing? The presence of a God who shines brightest in the midnight hour like fireflies in abandoned houses on summer nights, and in the mystery of his sovereignty, he always finds a way to be right on time, takes no magnifying glass to see the evidence of this sin. The need for a savior to suffer and sacrifice and die and then resurrect just to ensure that the price paid will suffice. And what does he ask of me? Other than to dig deep enough to find the Stephen crushing the pride inside of my soul, to lay down my life in the same manner that Christ gave his for me. In John 15, Jesus says that greater love has no one than this, that someone would lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. And isn't this the beauty of the gospel, that even in not having to be the perfect man that Jesus was to receive salvation, we still are given the responsibility of embracing the discomfort of this paradox, to die to self daily, as though the deeds of the flesh be victims to righteous murders, to take up your cross and follow Jesus as though your feet are made for walking, to evangelize without ceasing as though there's a Peter and Paul in your lungs, and your tongue is made strictly for talking about that Jesus of Nazareth. The same Jesus who experienced hematidrosis in the Garden of Gethsemane when he thought about the cup of wrath that awaited him. Led up Golgotha Hill like a lamb to its slaughterhouse, you know, so willing in its obedience to follow, so humble in its sacrifice, nailed to an old wooden cross.
rugged splinters piercing his skin, his flesh exposed to the foul of the air, his body beaten like slaves whose escape plans were interrupted by plantation overseers. The Savior of the lost hung his head and died, took on the full weight of every sin that there ever was and was to come, and consequently experienced disconnection with his Father, the God of the universe, for the first time in eternity. Jesus reached in his wallet and paid what I could not fathom. Jesus reached in his wallet and paid what you could not fathom. There are tattoos of despair within our wings. David said it like this: we are born in sin, brought forth in iniquity. Sickening is the state of these heights. Soaring blindly like eyeless eagles, in the slightest, simply, solely, sightless. Your blood, Jesus, is thicker than any pyru bond. Leaking from hands that cradle me through controversy. Provide peace like elementary field trips to the pumpkin patch that is serenity here. In the same manner that the clouds blow kisses to one another in the sky, we angels, ordained by God's voice, controlled solely and wholly by God's will, watch us. We fly.
And we're crying, oh, there's nobody like you, Lord. There's nobody like you, Lord. Yeah, we're crying,
no.